Hello aspirants, looking at current affairs for 5th August, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 11. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, cattle trade ban rules were not placed before parliament. So this is through an RTI request that we come to know, the response which has come from the Lok Sabha Secretariat, that these rules, cattle trade ban rules, which we have seen, these were the rules formulated under Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. So this Act of 1960, under this, rules as Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, Regulation of Livestock Market Rules of 2017 were formulated, and these called for ban on sale of cattle in livestock markets for the purpose of slaughter or animal sacrifices. So there were many petitions which came before the central government against these rules, against the provisions of these rules, and many cases were filed in the judiciary too. Supreme Court also saw many cases being filed before it. So government, in response to the Supreme Court, has stated that we have put a stay on the operation of these rules, and these rules are back to the drawing board, means they will be re-looked into and reformulated. So this is the statement coming from the government, and now an RTI response shows that these rules were not placed before the parliament, which is mandatory because section 38A says so of the act under which these rules were made. So the act says, the parent act says, that the rules which are made under this act should be placed before each house of the parliament as soon as it is made. So this has not been done. The rules would be placed before the parliament for a total of 30 days, it is stated. And any modification agreed upon by both houses should be incorporated in the rules, otherwise the rules have no effect. So this is mentioned in the act itself, but this has not been done. The additional Solicitor General in this case, also representing the government, said that we'll go back and look into it. So he needed time to look into what the issue which has been raised now under this. Also, the government has stated that we are not going to implement the provisions of these rules, but the Supreme Court asked that only the government saying that we are not going to implement does not have any significance, because rules were once notified are law. So government cannot say we'll not implement them. The rules continue to operate until the government repeals them or issues an order of injunction. So this is the Chief Justice of India stating. So this is regarding these rules. You can see the response as such of the Chief Justice of India to a Supreme Court judge too, that this requirement is mandatory of placing before the parliament. The next is, now Aadhaar required for death certificates. Now Aadhaar has been made mandatory for issuing of death certificates. So the Registrar General of India, which is the authority under Ministry of Home Affairs, this is responsible for conducting the census. As such, the decadal censuses which are conducted in the country too, as well as maintaining register of births and deaths. So it has been stated now that the death certificates would be issued only if Aadhaar number of the deceased is provided, and if the person is not having an Aadhaar number, as per the knowledge of the members, family members or relatives, any person who is applying for the death certificate, that person will have to provide an affidavit stating that to the best of his knowledge, that person does not possess an Aadhaar certificate. And this affidavit, if anybody lies under this affidavit, then action would be taken against him. So this is what the government has announced now, and this provision will come into effect from 1st October 2017. So all death certificates would be issued either when Aadhaar number is provided or when such an affidavit is provided. And this will not be applicable to three states, that is Jammu and Kashmir, Meghalaya and Assam. The reason being that here Aadhaar enrollment has been quite low. So this is the announcement which has now been made. So that this would be, and if false declaration is given, so it would be an offence under Aadhaar Act also and Registration of Births and Deaths Act also. Of course, they are saying that it's actually under the state government that registration of births and deaths takes place. So the states have been asked to show their preparedness by September 1st, 2017, and the new rules will come into effect by 1st October 2017. So this is there. It's under Section 57 of the Aadhaar Act of 2016, which empowers the government to make Aadhaar mandatory for various provisions. So use of Aadhaar for establishing identity of an individual for any purpose, for any law, for any contract to this effect can be done by the government. So this is there. Also under Registration of Births and Deaths, which is done under this Act, the corresponding rules will be made by the state governments. here this is regarding the Aadhaar being made mandatory from 1st October. Then next is no environment damage due to Lavasa. So this is the statement being made in Maharashtra Legislative Assembly by Environment Minister of Maharashtra. But this is an issue of environmental concern and of significance because this is a huge region, Lavasa. The Lavasa Lake City in Pune district, which is being developed by a private sector. So it's a hill station location around 60 kilometers from Pune, which has been built from scratch. But there have been many controversies. The construction work here has started. The project has been conceptualized almost a decade ago. And few years back, the construction has also been stopped here any further. So this is because of controversies, you can see, regarding rampant tree falling. Then several environment laws been violated. Forceful acquisition of land from the owners in this region. So such allegations have been put forth, and the issue is before the central government too, and the Union Environment Ministry has stopped the work on the project a few years ago. So this is being built in phases. This, as you see, in Pune district. So this is the Western Ghats region. So there is green norms also violated. That is why Union Environment Ministry has intervened. And it has in May 2017 been announced that Lavasa will be brought under the purview of Pune Metropolitan Regional Development Authority. So this is a significant change which has been made, because earlier the city enjoyed, Lavasa city itself enjoyed a status of special planning authority. So it could manage its own affairs. Now it's going to come under Pune Metropolitan Regional Development Authority. So this is regarding Lavasa and the allegations against it, like violation of green norms, etc. So the Environment Ministry intervened. So this is a map location also shown from Pune. This is the region here, Lavasa, which has, you know, plot, apartments, hotels, information technology centers, education centers, biotech parks, recreational facilities spread across 5 towns which have been developed under this Lavasa project. Then the next news item is ISRO set to launch satellite with corrected clocks. So this is regarding NAVIC, Navigation Indian Constellation. So this NAVIC is the regional GPS which India is developing. So GPS, Global Positioning System, is of USA. Even Russia has developed its positioning system, GLONASS. We all use GPS as an application to know the location on maps, to know the routes, where are you located at particular point to. So all this information you get through GPS system. So this GPS system, Russia has its own independent system called GLONASS. Even European Space Agency has developed its system called Galileo. And India is also developing its system, and that has been given the name NAVIC. Earlier it was known as Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, and the satellites are named. So you can see IRNSS-1A was the first satellite which was launched in July 2013. And since then, all seven, it's a constellation of 7 satellites. So this 7 satellites, all of them have been launched. The last one, IRNSS-1G, was launched in April 2016, put in orbit. So here now what we have seen in news, we have discussed about this earlier too, IRNSS-1A. And each of these satellites has 3 rubidium atomic clocks for accurate positioning. So this is an important component of global positioning system, which these atomic clocks are the most accurate of the clocks. So they provide you accurate positioning as such. So that is very important, especially because global positioning system or regional navigation system also, it has application for common use too, plus it has application requirement for defense purposes too. So such critical requirements, in those cases you require exact accurate information, you know, about to the point precise location at particular time. So that is why these rubidium clocks are very important. And in IRNSS-1A, all 3 rubidium clocks have failed in mid-2016. So this had been in news. So now this satellite is being replaced, and another satellite is actually being launched. So this is IRNSS-1H. So this is the satellite, the 11th one now, which will be launched towards the end of August 2017. So again, towards the end of this month, we'll be having this in news. So this you should know. Also, ISRO's head says that these rubidium atomic clocks, which have been used in these satellites, they have been sourced from a Swiss company. And the same Swiss company has also provided such atomic clocks to European Space Agency's Galileo, the first 18 satellites of its navigation system Galileo. So they also developed similar problems around the same time. So now these problems have been rectified and the clocks which are there presently will are expected to not suffer from such problems. So this is the information here which you know, and you know positional details as such, it says it's vital for, as I said, civilian and military purposes. So military, aviation, defense needs, ATMs, etc. Apart from traveling by land, sea or air route, a GPS and navigation system becomes important. So this is there. Also, ISRO head has said that INSS-1A is still functional. It is still sending information. So it's sending low powered messages, and these messages as such, weather data is being useful for fishermen even now. So this is there. Also he says that actually 4 satellites are also sufficient. So all functionalities can be undertaken by 4 satellites as such too, but we have a larger constellation. That is the way satellites are launched, so that if anyone fails, the entire system should not stop. So this is the, it will have a range of, you can see, 1500 kilometer. So this is the whole detail of this system, Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. So under this IRNSS, there are 7 satellites, 3 are in geostationary orbit and 4 are in geosynchronous orbit. What is the difference between these 2 types of orbits? That also we will see. You can see the orbital altitude is 36,000 kilometers at which these orbits lie, and the cost of the entire project as such also estimated is shown. It covers India and up to 1,500 kilometers beyond our borders. So it is giving services beyond the borders as well. So it can be available to neighbors as well, as per, you know, the decision of the government as such. So you can see there are 3 rubidium atomic clocks in each satellite, and this is what we were speaking of, which have become faulty as such in the first navigation satellite too. So GPS receivers will not work. You need specific receivers, and these are yet to be developed, because GPS has been developed by USA. So this is the navigation system which India is developing. So you can see 4 are in geosynchronous and 3 in geostationary orbits as such placed, and giving this coverage, a navigation system. So now what is the difference between geosynchronous and geostationary satellites? That is shown here. So this is, you can see the orbital distance will be the same, but how the orbit is placed, its angle with the axis of rotation, so that differs. When it is at 90 degree as such, the orbital inclination is at 90 degree with axis of rotation, then it is called geostationary orbit, means it's flat, you can see, completely flat. And if so geostationary orbit is also one particular type of geosynchronous orbit. Geosynchronous orbit can be at any inclination. So there are different number of geosynchronous orbits which are possible, a multiple number of geosynchronous orbits, but geostationary orbit at the altitude of 36,000 kilometers only one. So all satellites are at the same distance but in different orbits. So here, to give a complete coverage, this has been worked. So you can see what is a geosynchronous orbit. So it is having the same period of revolution as period of rotation of the Earth. So from the satellite will always cover the same position on the surface of the Earth. If the Earth is rotating, this satellite is revolving. So that's how it happens. So this is there. Then geostationary orbit is a circular geosynchronous orbit at zero inclination with the angle of axis of rotation. Then this is the details given regarding IRNSS-1A2, the first satellite launched, and how, you know, it has resulted in trouble with its rubidium atomic clocks. And these are the launch dates of all the satellites given as such, and the specifications of the satellites. Then next is ISRO to rely on CSIR for keeping satellite clocks accurate. So we have the National Physical Laboratory of CSIR, Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, and this body had also been in news a month or two back, when it was stated that this services which are provided, the main service which it provides to the country, is that it is the timekeeping authority in the country. The accurate clocks as such, based on which the time is maintained in the country, the authority for maintaining the Indian standard time as such is with the National Physical Laboratory of CSIR. So as CSIR, we have seen, is seeing a fund crunch. It has called for all the institutions under it to garner funds as such through internal sources rather than depending on government. So that is why National Physical Laboratory came up with this plan that it would be selling its data as such. So accurate time is required for ISRO's for its satellites. So here we are seeing that a deal as such, a memorandum has been signed between CSIR and ISRO, and now National Physical Laboratory will be given the job of maintaining the clocks in high precision as such. So the clocks as such, the time which was earlier taken was of US GPS. So now it will be National Physical Laboratory which will be providing these services to ISRO. So you can see until now the satellites on Navik were relying on US GPS to ensure that the clocks were working at high precision as required in satellite based system. So now the clocks on the satellites are working on high precision. This should be ensured by NPL itself, and for this NPL will be required to upgrade its infrastructure. So it will upgrade its timekeeping infrastructure and provide these services to ISRO. So this memorandum has already been signed. So here is the detail given about NPL, also National Physical Laboratory, about how it is the authority in India to maintain Indian standard time and the accuracy with which it maintains this time presently. Its accuracy of plus minus 20 nanoseconds, and it is the authority through which the entire world connects for Indian standard time, IST. Then next is Supreme Court seeks government's response on Jairam's petition. So Congress MP Jairam Ramesh, he is a former environment minister too, a prominent member of Congress. He had been responsible, we have discussed about him, how during GM crops too, as an environment minister, he had put a restriction on allowing GM crops. So a moratorium had been placed. Also Genetic Engineering Approval Committee had been renamed as Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. So he had played a prominent role then too. Later, he was shifted to Rural Development Ministry. So he was Rural Development Minister, but he brought in efficiency even in MGNREGA. So this is there. So here you can see Mr. Jairam Ramesh, he has questioned the provisions of Finance Act of 2017. So under this Finance Act, there is this section 184 as such, which has been added. So we'll discuss that, but you should know what is Finance Act. So there, when the budget is passed by the parliament, it's actually two bills passed by the parliament. So parliament always passes bills. So budget pass means two bills, appropriation bill and finance bill being passed. So means appropriation is how the allocation would be done. Appropriation would be done by the government, and finance is where the finances would come from. So these are the two bills which are passed by the parliament, becoming Appropriation Act and Finance Act. So for the budget 2017, the Finance Act 2017, which has been passed, some provisions of it are being questioned here in this petition before the Supreme Court. And now Supreme Court has asked the government to respond on these, you know, questions which have been raised. So you can see the question which has been raised is regarding section 184 of this Finance Act of 2017, in which the powers are being given back to the government now. The tribunals, appellate tribunals and other authorities as such, which are established, their appointment, term of office, qualification, salary, allowances, etc. These can be modified by the central government. So Mr. Jairam Ramesh is arguing that this is excessive delegation of powers to the government, because even the tribunal, like the National Green Tribunal as such, the National Green Tribunal is the authority which looks into environment related cases as such. It's headed by a retired former Supreme Court judge himself. So that is why now the government will have the power to, you know, decide everything regarding their qualifications, terms of office, etc., renewal, etc. So this is been power given to the government, whereas before the National Green Tribunal, the government itself is a party in majority of the cases. So when this is the case and you have the power to decide the composition, etc., through rules, it has been given this power. So this is being said to be excessive delegation of power. So the legislature has the authority to decide all these matters, and if excessive delegation goes to the executive, then this can be a question raised before the Supreme Court. So this is what we are seeing in this present case. Then next is Motor Vehicles Bill sent to Rajya Sabha. So this is regarding the Motor Vehicles Amendment Bill of 2017. This bill has been in news for quite some time now. It has already been passed by the Lok Sabha and now it is before the Rajya Sabha. So in the Rajya Sabha, it has been decided that this bill will be sent to a select committee of the Rajya Sabha, which will look into the provisions of the bill, prepare a report, and that would be praised before the Rajya Sabha. So this will be taken up by Rajya Sabha for voting in winter session. So this has been decided now. It will be passed as such in winter session, not presently. So this bill is seeking to amend the 30-year-old Motor Vehicle Act of 1988. And the Road Transport Minister, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, has also argued that this bill, as it has been stated, is not privatizing state transport authorities. So states have the power as such. They can accept or reject the bill's provisions. So it's up to the states, he says. So this is being stated. He calls it one of the biggest reforms in the sector, the transport sector. These are the major provisions of this bill already passed by Lok Sabha. So it is putting a cap on third party insurance. In the country, third party insurance is mandatory. Means third party in this case is, first party is the person who is taking the insurance. Second party is the insurer, insurance company. And the third party is the person who would be affected. So this, when an accident or so if it occurs, then the third party insurance, whatever the claims being made, this insurance cover is mandatory. Every person has to take this third party insurance cover. So what this bill is trying to do is that third party insurance liability is being capped. So maximum liability for third party insurance in case of motor accident is being capped by this bill as rupees 10 lakh in case of death and 5 lakh in case of grievous injury. So this is being provided. Also, Motor Vehicles Accident Fund would be created to provide compulsory insurance cover to all road users in the country in certain types of accidents. Other provisions under the bill include provisions for taxi aggregators. So we are seeing that presently taxi aggregators like Ola, Uber are becoming prominent. So there will be guidelines as such, definition of taxi aggregators and guidelines for them as determined by the central government are being provided for in the bill. And also other provisions are regarding amending the categories of driver licenses as such, then recall of vehicles in case of defects. This is being covered as such. Protection of good Samaritans. This has been a major requirement as such. So in case of civil or criminal action, good Samaritans means when there is a road accident as such, people who come forward and help the victims. So this is a good Samaritan. People don't come forward and help because they feel that they will be involved in that particular case. They'll be called as witness. They will be having to go to police stations regularly, and all that makes people not coming forward and helping. And that initial time after the accident is very important. It's called the golden hour, the first hour, when the life can be saved. But delay at that time results in deaths. So loss of life. So that is why good Samaritans have to be protected. So this is an important requirement which is also being put forth in this act. It is the Supreme Court which has also, you know, given its rulings on this particular issue. And then there are provisions for increasing penalty for several traffic offenses as such. So these are the major provisions under this bill. Then next is new bill to allow states to drop no detention policy. So this bill has been formulated now so that the states can decide if they want or don't want the no detention policy. So no detention policy of RT Act, we have discussed quite often now. A few days back too, we had discussed this. This is Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act of 2009. So this RTE Act, as it is called, this has this provision of no detention. So this no detention policy, which is there under this act, so it's mandatory for every school to follow it in the country. Means you cannot detain students up to class 8. So the student has to be promoted. So this, it has come forth, reports have come forth that this has resulted in the level of education going down. The provision was brought forth that it will reduce the dropout rates. Because if the child is not promoted, and generally the child lose interests and they drop out of school. So dropout rates, it is said they have reduced. So up to class 8, it is said dropout rates are just 4%. But after that, again, dropout rates rise above 20%. So that is bound to take place. So this up to class 8, when there is no detention policy, in general, the level of education is also seen to be going low. That's why many states have also agreed, and the central government has decided that this provision would be inserted in this act through an amendment. RTE Act would be amended so that detention can be allowed. So the provision is that there will be board exams. The exams as such in class 5 and class 8. So these class 5 and class 8 exams, this had already been discussed. The government had come forth with this idea. So these external exams in class 5 and class 8 will result in seeing the progress of the child, and if the child is progressing well, they will be promoted. If the child fails, then he will be given another chance to attempt for this exam. same class, and if again they fail, then they would be detained. If they pass in the second attempt too, they would be promoted. So in class 5 and class 8, this would be made provision for. So this again, the government has clarified that this is the domain of the state governments. They can decide whether they want no detention policy or they want to eliminate it. Actually, the government says that 25 states have agreed with this idea of removing no detention policy except 4. These are Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Maharashtra. They want to continue with this no detention policy is what is being seen as of now. So this is there. Then next is 20 select institutions to be outside UGC purview. So UGC, University Grants Commission, and All India Council for Technical Education, these are the apex education regulators as such, higher education regulators in the country. They will lose their power to regulate 20 higher educational institutions in the country. So this is the central government's proposal to develop 20 institutions as institutes of eminence. So 10 from government and 10 from private institutions would be selected. And these 20 institutions would be given complete autonomy. The idea is that they should break into the top 500 world rankings as educational institutions in a decade, in 10 years. So this, they will have complete freedom to decide their curriculum, decide what kind of faculty they want to hire, domestic, foreign faculty, variable pay they can provide to them. Also, they can fix the fee structure of their choice. But to ensure that meritorious but poor students are also enrolled in these institutions, financial support will be provided by the government. So now to select these 20 institutions, a search cum select committee, selection committee will be formulated. So this committee is comprising of cabinet secretary, even UGC chairman. So this is going to choose these 20 institutions. They are free to pick up any 20 institutions, 10 from government, 10 from private sector, and they will be given this full freedom. So we have many institutions which are among the top 50 in this recent rankings. The second set of rankings also had come forth. This is the new initiative of the central government. National Institute Ranking Framework, NIRF rankings. So these NIRF rankings which have come forth based on this also, and you know, a consistent A plus score coming from even NAC, National Assessment and Accreditation Council, which grades as such the institutions. This will decide. This will be used as a criteria to decide which institutions are picked up. So this is shown here. You can see the applicants will come forth to the top universities as such across the globe. Are these, you can see top 10 are shown. It is California Institute of Technology, which ranks number 1. Then comes Oxford, Stanford, Cambridge University, Massachusetts University. So these are shown. And the institutions from India, which are among the top 500 presently. So these are Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru, IIT Bombay, IIT Delhi, Kharagpur and Madras. So these are among the top 500 rankings. IIS Bangalore is in top 300 ranking. And this is regarding NIRF, the initiative which has been taken. The second list has also come forth of rankings now. So in the first phase, it had given separate rankings depending on which, you know, field the educational institutions are in. Now a combined ranking was provided in the second rankings which recently came forth. So here you can see the assessment parameters are these 5: teaching and learning resources, research and professional practices, graduation outcomes, outreach and inclusivity of the institution, and perception of the institution too. So these are the parameters based on which the ranking is provided, and these are the top 10 educational institutions as per NIRF rankings. So you can see again IIS Bangalore is at number 1. Then comes the IITs, JNU and BHU are also there in the top 10. Then next is revival of Buckingham Canal. So this is regarding the Buckingham Canal, which was established by the British colonial rulers during that time, during British rule. So this canal is around 796 kilometers long, a freshwater navigation canal as such. It runs parallel to the Coromandel coast of South India. It starts from Kakinada in East Godavari district of Andhra Pradesh and runs up to Villupuram district in Tamil Nadu. So the map as such is also given here. You can see the various names which it has had. Earlier it was called Lord Clive's Canal. Then later it was given the name, of course, before that it was called Cochrane Canal. Then it became Lord Clive's Canal, and finally it got its name Buckingham Canal on the order of Duke of Buckingham in 1878. So this is the canal. It, you know, connects the natural backwaters along the coast of Chennai too. office is there. So here you can see the map also, we can have a look at it. So here this is the region from where this Buckingham Canal is running. You can see now it has been extended, so its total length now is 1095 kilometer. And this canal is presently, in some regions it has become dry, in some regions there is huge amount of waste which is dumped here. So there is a need to revive this Buckingham Canal, and a project has been initiated by the central government. So the thing is that this canal has now been declared as a national waterway in 2008. So you can see this action has resulted in National Waterway 4. This is the Buckingham Canal given this status, and now the government has come with a grand plan to revive this canal, and this has been initiated with the help of Inland Waterways Authority of India. So this is the authority which is going to implement this grand project of 2000 crore announced in 2016 by the central government. Even an MOU has been signed between the central government and Andhra Pradesh government. So an SPV would be established, and even Vishakhapatnam Port Trust has been involved in this. So this is to develop the waterway to a class 3 navigation standard, right? So 1000 ton capacity vehicles can also run over here. So even dredging would be done in this region. So this is regarding this canal now. So some challenges of course are there, as you can see that it will result in, you know, it will require maintaining the water level in the canal first of all, because even connectivity is being proposed to Krishna River. And Krishna River also, we are seeing that major part, as you can see here. So major part says Krishna River is important for this revival project. So this is having less inflows. So if the river itself is having less inflows, then how will the canal be revived? So this is concern. Then also there will be many bridges built haphazardly on its course, which will have to be removed. So removal of these bridges is also a concern. There are encroachments on the canal bands. So these will have to be removed. So there will be a huge initiative which would be required, spending and willingness required to ensure that this Buckingham Canal can be revived. Then the next news item is India-US-Iran tensions grow. So this is regarding US-Iran relations. The nuclear deal, it is said to be under threat now, because the actions which are being taken by US against Iran is threatening that the deal would fall apart. The deal, you should know, is not only between US and Iran, but all other nations, P5 nations are involved here, part of this deal. So here you can see the issue which has come. Fourth, there are new sanctions which have been imposed by USA on Iran. So this will result in retaliation, and a threat to the deal exists. Here you can see new sanctions which have been imposed because of the ballistic missile program which has been initiated by Iran. This is it. Then another thing which is mentioned is regarding the bill which was passed recently by the Senate, which is imposing more restrictions on not only Russia, North Korea, but also Iran. So these concerns have been raised. Also, President Trump has been highly critical of this bill. So he has reluctantly approved that Iran is complying with the provisions of this bill twice, but now he is no longer to go ahead with it anymore. Then next is, center starts ETF for PSU's lenders. So this is regarding a new exchange traded fund which has presently been announced by the finance minister. This has been given the name Bharat 22. So this comprises of 22 stocks of central public sector undertakings. These are PSUs, public sector banks, SUTI included. So here you can see this Bharat 22 is a well diversified exchange traded fund spanning 6 sectors: basic materials, energy, finance, FMCGs, fast moving consumer goods, industrials and utilities, all are included under this. Now power utilities, etc. So this, all these public sector central public sector undertakings have been formed as a exchange traded fund. So first of all, of course, we'll see what is an exchange traded fund. Apart from that, the other facts are that ICICI Prudential has been appointed as the ETF manager here for Bharat 22, and Asia Index Private Limited is the index provider. So this is an index as such which will be prepared, means there will be weightage given to each of these units. So you can see for basic materials, energy, the weightage given is shown here. So it includes banks also, which is said to be making it more attractive to the consumers as such, to people trade on the stock exchange. So this is going to facilitate disinvestment for the government. So disinvestment target, which has been set forth for 2017, has not been achieved to the extent required, because last financial year 2016-17, the target was for disinvestment of 45,500 crores, and the government realized 46,247 crores above the target. But this year's target was set as 72,500 crores, but till now it has only achieved 9,300 crores. So first of all, understanding what is an exchange traded fund. So this as having the features of both a stock as well as a mutual fund. A stock means which is not traded on the stock exchanges. So stocks are tradable during the day. You can buy and sell. So that is a feature which exchange traded funds have, and they act like a mutual fund too, in the sense that they are diversified. So these are diversified funds that trade like a stock. So this Bharat 22, as we saw, this is an exchange traded fund. So it has an index. All these entities will be having their stake here. So based on their performance as such, the exchange traded funds value will be calculated. So that index is there, that is finalized. The weightage has also been finalized, and this exchange traded fund can be traded on the stock exchange like a stock. So mutual fund is what is a mutual fund, you should understand, is that you have a mutual fund house. So this mutual fund house takes your money and invests in various stocks, diversified stocks, which based on its skills, it understands which stocks will do better rather than an individual stock person on the stock exchange. The mutual funds are experts here, and they decide where to invest and give you better returns. So of course, they charge a fee for this service which they provide to you. So of course, diversification and better returns can be ensured in lieu of a fee from mutual funds. So exchange traded funds are giving you that. So diversified funds, you are investing in number of stock, public sector undertakings here. So that is it. So here you can see this is shown how in stock exchange, from small investor to small investor, exchange traded funds can be traded. But mutual funds, they are direct transaction from the fund house to the small investor, that they are sold like that. And here you can see the details provided. So this is that the quoted price. So when they are brought and sold on the stock exchange, the quoted price on the stock exchange is the rate at which this transaction takes place. This takes place at the net asset value, which is calculated for a particular mutual fund at the end of the day. So that is how it goes. And the details here also of diversification benefit in exchange traded funds, how are they? Management fees is also there in this case, but it is quite low. You can see 50% less too from mutual funds. So this is quite low. So these are the benefits you get. They can be traded on the stock exchange. So this is the benefit which is not there as with mutual funds. So they are more liquid as such, exchange traded funds. And this is regarding Bharat 22, the various components, the companies which are there, 22 companies under it, and the weightage for each of them. So here you can see it is diversified, various sectoral public sector companies under it. And this is regarding ETFs. So they are like mutual funds, but with a defined asset basket, like shares of an index. So they have a defined basket. Mutual funds, there is no fixed. That is the decision of the fund house. And they are more liquid than mutual funds, as they can be traded on stock exchange. So this is that. So these are the news items. Thank you.